before my freshman year in high school, and I was doing like I used to do back in those days with my devotional time. I would take my Bible, and wherever it flopped open, that was God's word for me that day. That's how I thought God spoke, and so you just kind of pray, God speak to me, and you let it fall open, and wherever you put your finger, that's where God wanted you to receive something of value. Well, on a particular day, my Bible fell open to Psalm 37, verse 4. The scripture says there, let me just refresh your memory, delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. As I'm sitting there that day, I'm like, cha-ching, I've got it. I've got the golden ticket. This is the magic lamp of Christianity. It's my ace in the hole. It's kind of like the combination lock to unlock the treasure trove of happiness. Love God and get everything you want. You ever been there? I'm like, sign me up. I'm thinking girlfriends. I'm thinking jobs. I'm thinking good grades without studying. I mean, I'm all over the place. I am going to be the happiest dude in the history of high school. It made sense to me at that time, and it appealed to my selfish nature. Anybody else ever get into something like that? It's like, man, and the best of this whole thing is it's in the Bible. I mean, nobody's going to argue with me on this. I mean, this is God's word. Love me and get all the stuff that'll make you happy. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He'll give you the desires of your heart. And then you start looking further, and Psalm 97:12 says, but the godly are happy. God wants me happy. That's amazing. And then you read over in James chapter 4, verse 2, and you find out, you have not because you ask not. I'm like, oh man, who hasn't found this before? This is like the secret of the great life. Why aren't we all in? And why hasn't somebody taught me this? Why did I have to find it to myself? But it was deeply flawed thinking and deeply flawed theology. You see, there's three implications that kind of come from this. Love God and you get everything you want. Because one of the implications becomes, whatever makes me happy must be right. And if anything makes me unhappy, it's got to be wrong. A second implication comes from this kind of thinking is that discomfort and delay and suffering and inconvenience can in no way be ever part of God's plan. And then the third implication is we start to seek the wrong things. We start chasing after things like money and pleasure and comfort and happiness. Understand this, okay? God cares about our happiness. He really does. He's a good father. We sing about it from time to time. The Bible says that He is the giver of every good and perfect gift. The Bible tells us that we are the apple of His eye and that He rejoices over us with singing. However, God desires that we pursue Him over happiness. God wants us to go after Him and not just the happy life. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. Jeremiah 29:11, it's a favorite for Christians to memorize. Maybe you've got it memorized. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and the future. And then we stop right there. But if you go on to verses 12 and 13, you kind of get another wrinkle of this scripture. Then you will call on me, it says in verse 12, and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Verse 13, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. God wants us to be a seeking people, not seeking happiness, but seeking Him. And then like it says in Psalm 37, delight yourself in the Lord. It's what we need to be focusing on, delighting ourselves in the Lord, and He will give us the desires of our heart. But how many of us focus on the latter part of that verse? He will give us the desires of our heart. And when we do that, have you noticed how your prayer life changes? When you focus on what God can give me, what God needs to give me, I think about maybe some of the prayers that I've prayed this last week. They're just this laundry list of my happiness. God, would you bless this? God, would you give me that? God, would you take care of this painful situation? God, would you eliminate this discomforting place over here? God, give me, help me, bless me. It's all about me, me, me. Our prayer lists at that point become a list of selfishness and self-serving ideals of happiness. At that point, we begin to look toward the gifts rather than the giver, don't we? We start looking for God's hand rather than seeking His face. It's kind of like if my kids were to come to me and they're always looking for a handout, and they don't come and they talk to me anymore, they don't look me in the face, they don't talk to me, they just look at my hand and what I can bring out of my pocket or my wallet or what I can do for them. It demoralizes me as a dad because I want relationship with them. I want to be connected. I want them to see me. I want them to want me, not just what I can give. And it's the same thing with God. When we start believing that God is about our happiness, we kind of put God into a category that He exists to serve us.